All right, so welcome to Anti-Oedipus, Deleuze and Guattari Beyond the State. I'm glad to see all of you here. Before we get started, it would be my preference that if you can, please leave your monitor on or your camera on so I can see you. In addition to that, I would prefer that you not type in the sidebar. That tends to interrupt discussion. And so maybe we could begin by all of you introducing yourselves and telling me a little bit about yourself and your background before we jump into things. And hopefully we'll have discussion here. So Adam, if you could start. You're on mute.
My name is Adam Stein. I live in Baltimore. I graduated from college last year. I got a bachelor's in philosophy at a continental department, one of the few. And I guess I sort of mainly consider continental philosophy sort of my field of interest academically, but I sort of came to it through psychology. So that's sort of another interest for me that makes Anti-Oedipus interesting to me. So, yeah.
Okay, great. And I noticed you're moving around quite a bit.
And I might go on to. Oh, yeah.
And.
Yeah, is that distracting?
I can turn off. Huh? What were you gonna say?
Hello. Is that distracting?
A little bit. Yeah. But if you prefer to move, maybe you could turn off your camera. That would be fine as well.
Okay.
All right, Daniel.
Okay. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
My name is Daniel. I think almost everyone here took the previous seminar with you on where we read 1,000 Plateau. Yeah, right. Well, I studied political science here in Mexico. I'm currently doing the certificate program in social and political thought here at the New Center. What else? Well, my main formation is political theory and state theory. Most of it of the Marxist strand, but I'm very interested in continental philosophy, but more or less critical philosophy from the second half of the 20th century. So we did the previous seminar, and I don't quite remember, but we kind of had reached an agreement to read Anti-Oedipus after. So that's why I'm here, basically.
Yeah, quite a bit of this project, sorry I had to shoo a cat away, quite a bit of this project arose out of the discussions the last semester revolving around the state, and so hopefully we explore some difficult or interesting material with respect to that. All right, Michael.
Hi, Michael Downs. I think I know everybody here today. Certificate student here at the New Center in the philosophy program. Just working on that right now. And let's see, basic interest in philosophies range from... Lacanian psychoanalysis to Deleuze and post-structuralism. And recently, you know, I've been taking Jason's class on media theory and political theory, and finding that I really like media theory a lot. Probably going to end up studying a lot more of that. So that's basically the general areas of philosophy I'm primarily interested in.
Great. Is Thelma?
Sorry.
You're on mute.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Salma, and I'm from Bosnia and Herzegovina. Still living there, only changed cities quite recently. And yeah, I also took the previous course on Deleuze and Guattari. And I'm in the process of writing a thesis now on minor literature, basically working on a Bosnian American author. So that's one of the reasons I decided to take the class, apart from the agreement issuing from the previous course that we'll continue with Anti-Oedipus. So I'm glad to be here.
And finally, Theodore.
Hi, I'm Theodore. Can everybody hear me?
Mm-hmm.
I primarily come through an art history and visual arts background. Studied art history and art theory in undergrad at RISD, and yeah, I'm interested to read Deleuze. I've only read a little bit of Anti-Oedipus, so I'm interested to get more into it.
All right. All right, so today I was hoping to situate the course a little bit and discuss the project of critique. Hopefully you'll help me out a bit with discussion, so I'm not simply lecturing the entire time. But for me at least, part of the reason that I wanted to convene or conduct this seminar is because I want to understand Anti-Oedipus, right? And so for me, this has always been a very mysterious work. It's difficult for me to place within the Deleuzian context and to determine what exactly it is that they're up to in this text, which might not sound very reassuring to all of you who are here today. But the hypothesis that I wish to entertain over the course of the semester is that Anti-Oedipus is not, or should not be understood primarily as a as a critique of psychoanalysis or of the Oedipus. Certainly that is there at work throughout their thought in this text, but I want to suggest that Oedipus is another name for what Heidegger called ontotheology, or what Deleuze and Guattari often call fascism, or what we might call the state, right? And so, you know, there's a couple ways of approaching this text. You know, one way is to see this as a very directed text at psychoanalysis in France that's primarily interested in making an intervention there. And I think that for most of us, right, if that's what this text is doing, if that's all that this text is doing, outside of those of us who are involved with psychoanalysis in some way or another, this wouldn't be of very great interest. And maybe I'm mistaken in suggesting that. But it seems to me that this text is targeting something much broader, much deeper than psychoanalytic practice. And I think that we would refer to, if we wanted to give Anti-Oedipus another name, we could either call it a critique of Oedipal desire or Oedipal reason. Right? Who was that who laughed?
Adam,
okay. Or we could call it pure desire, right? This is what the project, it seems to me, that they're engaged in. And so, back here behind me on the board, I'm not sure how well all of you can see it. Right, I have an equation written up. Those of you who are familiar with Lacan will recognize this equation as the masculine side of Lacan's graph of sexuation. Right? And so the way in which this is being read, right, the top part here is that there exists an entity such that that entity, we see a negation sign up there, is not subject to what Lacan calls the phallic function, or what we could call the law. And underneath it, right, we have another statement, another proposition. For all entities, those entities are subject to, and I forgot my X here, to the law or the phallic function. And what I want to suggest with this graph, there are a lot of thoughts here that I have, is that this is the elementary structure of ontotheology, this is the elementary structure of metaphysics, and this is a highly condensed version of the Oedipus complex. And all of these things, it seems to me, are related in some way or another. And so I'm just going to go ahead and write in the sidebar for you. Hopefully I'm not belaboring this point, what these equations mean. So the top part, there exists an entity, and here I am violating my own rules by typing in the sidebar. There exists an entity that is not subject to the law. Now, I want you to notice something about this right away, this proposition. Some of you will be familiar with the work of Carl Schmitt, right, who's become very important in discussions about the nature of politics and discussions about the nature of the state. He's been particularly relevant to the work of people like Agamben and so on and so forth. And one of the claims that Schmitt makes is that politics is essentially grounded on an exceptional term that decides the exception, right? What constitutes a sovereign, Schmitt argues in, which book is it? Is it Political Theology? What constitutes a sovereign, according to Schmitt, is that the sovereign is that which decides the exception, right? And so the sovereign is this strange sort of figure, and I think that across the board, we should take him very seriously when he talks about a theology. Across the board, a sovereign could be something like, it could be God, if we're talking about the God of the traditional monotheistic theologies. It could be the sovereign king, it could be the dictator, it could be the father in the Oedipal scenario, right? But there is a certain term Schmitt wants to argue within social structure that is somehow both constitutive of the law but is an exception to the law. Right? This seems to be a key structure of ontotheology to me. When we think about the nature of God, what we think of God as being, God is somehow this being that is beyond or exceptional to the law. Right? And so the lower portion of this, this equation that we have up here on the board, it says, for all beings, those beings are subject to the law. Right? We have these two propositions, right? And for those of you who are familiar with Kant and his antinomies, these seem to mirror the Kantian antinomies, especially the dynamical antinomies. Maybe we'll talk about that later on. But to be a subject, right, is to be limited in some way, subject to the law in some way, subject to some sort of limitation. All right, now in the lower portion of this, what do we see? All right, we have the barred subject. That subject is barred because it has been subjected to the law, right? And because of introduction into the state or that social order, in a theological context, we might call this the doctrine of original sin, it has lost a portion of its being. Right, and that's what this is right here, this remainder of its existence that it's lost, right, and that is the partner that it seeks in these sorts of relationships. And so the sort of question that obsesses me and that I continuously return to, it's something that already in my very first published article back in 2003 or something like that, I was already struggling with this sort of issue, is that when we think about identity, right, the pursuit of identity, whether it be identity in the form of the ego or whether it be cultural identities that we might possess or national identities that we might possess, when we think about group formations such as political parties or national groups and so on and so forth, they very much seem to have this sort of structure, right? On the one hand, at the upper level there, we imagine an identity that would be pure, that wouldn't be limited or fissured from within in any sort of way, as if somehow I could assume, what Lacan calls my ideal ego and be identical to that, or that the nation could be without fissure inside of it, or that the party could be without conflict, without antagonism. This is a sort of fantasy, it seems to me, that haunts our minds in certain ways. But the reality is, right, the reality is that all of these identities, all of these group formations, the state, political parties, and so on, are fissured from within by antagonisms. And I think that this is a basic structure of attempting to form any sort of identity whatsoever. If we talk about Hegel's Science of Logic, which I believe to be essential reading, a lot of people spend their time on the Phenomenology of Spirit. It's a great work. But Hegel's Science of Logic, in my opinion, is really where it's at and well worth spending the time going through it. If we think through Hegel's Science of Logic, the second or third movement in the Science of Logic. And so first we have the dialectic of being and non-being, then we get becoming, and then we get the third movement, Dasein, what he calls his name for an object. Right?
Does he also call it determinate reality?
What's that?
Is it also called determinate reality? Is that the third
movement? This is in the doctrine of being and the first part of it. And yeah, it might be called determinate reality, right? But you know, the key point that he makes, right? It's been a while since I looked at it. The key point that he makes here, when talking about being a something, is that in order for something to be defined as something, it has to have a boundary, right? And in order for a boundary to be formed, that boundary has to define itself differentially, right? In terms of what it's not. And so there's a built-in, according to Hegel, instability within any sort of identity, because the boundary is this strange thing that is neither inside of the Dasein, inside of the something, nor outside of the something, right? Does the boundary, if we talk about the membrane of my body, something that Deleuze likes to talk about quite often, does the membrane belong to my body or does it belong to the outside world? Zizek makes this point beautifully when talking about cultural identities. He says, look, in order to define the essence of what it means to be English, I have to define myself against the Scottish, the Irish, the French, the Yanks, and so on and so forth. My identity is constituted by what it is not. And so we have this striving to be an identity that is without that sort of alterity within it. But on the other hand, we constantly find that identity, ego, ethnic identities, national identities are contaminated from within by this sort of differential logic. And this has real consequences, right? One of the things, once we finally get to later on in the semester, once we finally get to the Anti-Oedipus, one of the things that we are going to perpetually encounter is the opposite pole of schizophrenia, which is paranoia, right? And the way in which paranoia works is, in Lacan anyway, and Deleuze and Guattari are heavily drawing on Lacan in their work, the more that we attempt to purify and form our identity, to be identical to our identity, the more paranoid we get. And the more we feel as if we are being persecuted. And so what is it that is going on here? This is a structural logic of any sort of identity formation, according to this sort of logic. It's not because empirically we are being persecuted from without. Right, and so if you think about this in terms of the situation of National Socialism with the Nazis, right, the more that the National Socialists try to become pure Germans, the more they feel as if they're being contaminated by something that is not German, because they're encountering more and more and more this boundary logic that's precarious, that can never, right, achieve the status of being without subject to difference, right? And this generates a paranoid mentality. And so what do the Germans, of course, name this thing that is contaminating them from within? Right, they name it the Jew. But this really has nothing to do with Jewishness. This has everything to do with trying to be identical to our identity. And so we see this logic over and over again. It's something that in my own work, I can't find a way to navigate it because I find myself caught in a sort of antinomy, right? And so what, for those of you who are familiar with Kant, right, an antinomy is a logic in which we can give two valid arguments for opposed positions, right? And so, you know, the famous, antinomy in the Critique of Pure Reason, I can equally argue that the universe must logically have a beginning in time, and I can demonstrate that through a series of logical propositions. But on the other hand, I can just as easily give a demonstration that the universe is infinite in time and space, that it has no beginning. And you know what interested, and we'll talk about Kant here in a little bit, what interested Kant about these antinomies, these forms of reasoning, is that there's no obvious logical error at work in these antinomies. Right? It's not that the person who argues that the universe has an origin in time, whether it be the Big Bang or God, has made some sort of, fallen into some sort of logical fallacy. Their conclusion follows from the premises of their arguments. Likewise, on the other hand, right, the person who argues that the universe is infinite in time and space, they're not making any logical errors in their reasoning. Their argument is just as valid. Right? And Kant says, look, if this can happen, this is the euthanasia of reason. Reason is useless if it can lead to two opposite conclusions that are both based on valid reasoning. Well, it seems like we encounter something with respect to the political world as well, something that is really, for us, I think, at this point in time, coming to a fore. Right? On the one hand, we have the need to organize and form groups in order to have any effective political action whatsoever. Right? This is the sort of claim that Nick Cernusek and Alex Williams are making in their recent book. What's the title of it again? It's escaping me.
Inventing the future.
Inventing the future, right? You know, and so they critique this thing that they call folk politics, and they say, look, right, you know, right now on the left, there's this folk political idea of anarchistic engagement that is local, that doesn't have an overarching leader to it, or any of these sorts of things. No, instead, we have to form, you know, you see Jody Dean making similar arguments as well in her work. We need to form a strong party. We need to organize what I would call a state. We need to organize in order to effectively address the issues that we address. And they're absolutely correct, right? I mean, it seems like, you know, as much as it pains me to criticize Occupy Wall Street, what was the sort of standard criticism of Occupy Wall Street? That at these protests, you had a million different voices talking about an infinity of different issues, and there was no overarching organization to what they were doing. Right, there needed to be some sort of unity there. But the problem is that the minute we try to form a state, the minute we try to form a party or a unity, we immediately fall into this paranoid boundary logic, right, where we have to institute the friend-enemy distinction, and that friend-enemy distinction takes one of two forms. Right, the one form would be the constitution of an enemy as an outside. And so, you know, from my experience as somebody living in the United States, having grown up during the Cold War, we had the fall of the Soviet Union, All right, Selma, maybe you can talk a little bit about this. And when the Soviet Union fell in the United States, it's like Americans collectively lost their shit. We didn't know what to do with ourselves, or many of us didn't know what to do with ourselves, because American, United States identity had been constituted around not being the Soviets. That boundary logic again. They had their enemy, and they could say, we're going to see this logic unfolded in Nietzsche and philosophy when we get to that later on. They could say, we are good because they are bad. The logic of resentment, right? And when that collapses, the United States no longer has an enemy with which to define its existence. This is George Orwell in 1984 beautifully unfolds this logic. Oceania always has to be at war with somebody else in order to constitute itself collectively as Oceania. The minute they lose themselves, what happens to the United States? It becomes paranoid. And how does it become paranoid? Now the enemy is within. The OJA that is contaminating the purity of what it's supposed to be comes to be, right, and I owe this to my partner, my wife, pointing this out, comes to be all of these enemies inside of the states, inside of the nation that need to be fought. Smokers, there has to be a war on smokers. There has to be a war on this group, a war on that group. There is something that is preventing the unified identity from occurring within the United States, and that has to be fought. The problem is, right, that this is a structural logic. You can't eradicate that boundary logic. You can't eradicate that sort of fissure within any sort of group formation. We can destroy all of the enemies within and without that we might like, and we're still going to find more enemies because identity is constituted in this way. And so, you know, in the United States, there's almost a collective sigh of relief I don't know if I should say this when I'm being recorded, but when the United States gets a new enemy, terrorism, right, and just going back to George Orwell's 1984, does anybody remember who the nemesis is in 1984? Is it Goldberg? All right, that's the head of the dissident party, is that correct?
I believe it was Goldstein or something.
Goldstein,
like that.
Right, yeah, Goldstein. Right, you know, I mean, terrorism in certain ways is the perfect OJA to manage this sort of boundary logic. Because terrorism is something that is always lurking in the shadow. It is like the elusive snipe, right, and terrible snipe hunt, that every time you think you've captured it, it slips away and it's somewhere else. And so we get this sort of return of the repressed again and again and again. And so, you know, the sort of antinomy that really obsesses me when thinking about these sorts of issues is, and I don't know, it might be, you know, me trying to square the circle or something along these lines. Can we imagine a form of state or collective engagement or unified group that doesn't fall into the paranoia of this sort of boundary logic? Right? And I think Oedipus for Deleuze and Guattari, right? All of this might seem unrelated. I think Oedipus for Deleuze and Guattari is naming this structure. Right, where we elevate some term to being an exceptional term, being without any sort of fissure or gap, right, and nonetheless all of the members that belong to that term, that are subject to that term, are themselves with fissure or gap, and we get this logic of a divided subject that is attempting to surmount this problem. Can we imagine, can we think a form of organization that doesn't fall into this sort of logic? I think that is what is going on here in this text, Anti-Oedipus. So any remarks, comments?
Levi, would you say that, you know, with it being called Anti-Oedipus, I remember how you explained the symbolic father once. And, you know, the symbolic father, it isn't necessarily the literal father. It can be any type of social function that takes the mother away from the child, all of that type of thing. But, the reason that they filter their analysis through, you know, the Oedipus complex, I take it, is because the father has always been traditionally identified with this structure of, you know, the law or, you know, the sovereign, And so, in a sense, they would be against the standard, you know, interpretation of the Oedipus complex. But like you've said before, if you look at it through a certain Lacanian lens, it's right in line with what Lacan is saying.
In some respects, I mean, there are differences between, you know, Lacan and Deleuze and Guattari. There are going to be points of continuity. I think in a lot of ways, Deleuze and Guattari, or Lacan, is actually a good guy for Deleuze and Guattari. But then when you look at, you know, certain collections of essays, I forget which collection I'm thinking offhand. It's not the Desert Islands collection. I think it's Two Regimes of Madness, right? You know, their critique becomes much more pointed towards the logic of the signifier and these sorts of things in that text. But I think that on the one hand, right, you know, and this is why we need to talk, why I assigned Kant's critical philosophy as a reading for today, and if you didn't get through it, that is fine. Don't worry about that. We're not going to spend a whole lot of time on it. But if we think about the nature of the Kantian project of critique, which deeply informs everything that Deleuze in his own work is up to, right, we usually treat Kant, and Deleuze himself describes him in this terms, as one of his philosophical enemies. And that's true, right? It is true that Kant is one of his philosophical enemies, but Kant is also one of the key thinkers from which Deleuze draws a tremendous amount of his apparatus, right? And so we find, once we get to Anti-Oedipus, that a great deal of Anti-Oedipus is actually modeled on the Critique of Pure Reason, read through the third critique. And, you know, hopefully at some point I can explain what I mean by that. But we could say that the first chapter of Anti-Oedipus corresponds to Kant's Transcendental Aesthetic, which is all about the a priori structures of receptivity. The second and third chapter are the second chapter is the Kantian Transcendental Analytic, which is all about the principles of synthesis that unify the manifold of sensibility, right? And they're giving a different account of this. And then the remainder of the book is the chapters 3 and 4. Am I getting the number of chapters right? Chapters 3 and 4 are the Transcendental Dialectic, diagnosing the various illusions internal to, or chapter 3, yeah, pardon me, the various illusions internal to social reason and desiring reason. And finally, chapter 4 would be the Transcendental Doctrine of Method, how we're supposed to put all this to work concretely. And that's a really cryptic thing to say. And I fully confess that I've laid it out in this way to be somewhat clever for all of you. It's a somewhat strained analogy here. But when we think about the project of Kantian critique is never simply about demolishing what it is that it's critiquing. Right? It has to also account for what it is that it's critiquing. There is a certain truth, right, to these things that in the Transcendental Dialectic, Kant critiques. And so psychoanalysis, like all of society, according to Deleuze and Guattari, suffers from certain illusions, right? It suffers from the illusion of the Oedipus, from a conception of desire based on lack, right, rather than productivity, from a concept of the unconscious that is a theater rather than a factory, and we'll talk about what all these things might mean later on. It suffers from all sorts of illusions, but it is what Kant would call a well-founded illusion, right, that is internal to the nature of society or subjectivity itself. And that's something that has to be accounted for. And so, you know, so how to develop this? You know, I'm skipping so many things. So on the one hand, psychoanalysis itself has, just like the rationalist philosophers that Kant is responding to in certain ways, Spinoza, Leibniz, and Descartes, has fallen prey to a series of illusions, internal to reason. Psychoanalysis has fallen into these illusions as well with the Oedipus. It has things upside down, just like for Marx, Hegel has things upside down. It needs to be turned on its feet. Nonetheless, within psychoanalysis, there's also a truth that has been discovered, and that truth is the nature of the unconscious. And so if you read Freud's earliest writings, things like the Project Essay, things such as the early writings on the parapraxis, such as the interpretation of dreams, the psychopathology of everyday life, jokes in their relationship to the unconscious, and so on and so forth. What do you find in these works that are all pre-Oedipal? We can see seeds of Oedipus becoming the overarching explanation in all cases, but nonetheless, in many respects, these works are pre-Oedipal. What we find in Freud's early conception of the unconscious is that it's not a representational unconscious, it is a productive, or it is a creative, or it is a synthetic unconscious. And we're going to have to figure out, once we get to Anti-Oedipus, what that might mean. They're drawing on this early work, right? It's almost as if they want to save Freud and psychoanalysis from itself, right? But we need to have a critique. And so this is Kant's big idea, right? This idea of critique on the one hand, right? And so I don't know, how much do I need to talk about the sort of context that motivates Kant's critique of pure reason?
I mean, I think it's not a bad idea as a refresher. I think it's not a bad idea just as a refresher.
Okay, so we have this horrible situation, right, that is going on prior to Kant. And, what is that situation? We have, on the one hand, we have the great rationalist tradition, right? We have Descartes, we have Spinoza, and we have Leibniz. And all of these philosophers, these rationalists, and I think that they think of philosophy in a way fundamentally different from the way we think of philosophy today. They really thought, even though science doesn't emerge until the 19th century, they really thought they were giving us knowledge in a sort of clear-cut way, like we get from mathematics or something like that with their systems, right? These weren't individual creations for them. And all of them are claiming to arrive at conclusions about the nature of the universe as a totality, about the nature of God and the existence of God and why God created this universe, and about the nature of the soul and beings. All of them are claiming to arrive at conclusions through reason. I mean, these are guys that are all deeply impressed by mathematics. And what is the beauty of mathematics? The beauty of mathematics is that through the analysis of concepts, we are able to arrive at universal conclusions that everybody across the globe arrives at if they follow the same pattern of reason. We all come to the same conclusion with, say, the Pythagorean theorem. These are not based on observations of nature or the world around us. That is a remarkable thing. And then the most remarkable thing of all with respect to this is that reality itself turns out to have this structure. The mathematicians think the structure of reality before observing that reality, and it turns out that things are the same. I mean, this is an amazing thing. And so the rationalists, what do they say to themselves? And you'll notice that it's the rationalist tradition that are all the scientists. Descartes is a scientist. Leibniz is a scientist. You know, the rationalists, what do they say to themselves? They say, look, if we can have this kind of knowledge in the case of mathematics, maybe we can have this sort of a priori knowledge independent of experience with respect to things like God, the universe as a whole, the soul. And so they all think that they're doing this kind of geometry of the divine, of the soul, of the physical, the natural world, and their reasoning is good. Right? It's not as if Descartes, when he engages in his reasoning, maybe Descartes isn't the best example, it's not as if Descartes is engaged or falling into formal logical fallacies. It's not as if Spinoza's conclusions fail to follow from the definitions that he presents, the axioms and the postulates. These things follow. But what's the big problem? In the case of mathematics, everybody comes to the same conclusion. In different cultures, it's this remarkable, amazing thing, different cultures discover the same mathematical truths independently of one another. Newton at the same time as Leibniz discovers the calculus. This is remarkable. I mean, we would be shocked if we found an alien race that spoke the English language that had never had contact with English people, right? That doesn't happen, but we wouldn't be shocked if they had geometry, maybe. I don't know. That's become a contentious point at this point in history. So something is wrong here. And so Hume comes along, and what does Hume say? Hume says, you guys are all full of shit. Right? Hume says, before we can even begin to speculate about the nature of reality, before we can begin to speculate about the nature of God or the soul, we first need to investigate the tool by which, my apologies for the metaphor, the tools by which we know these things. That is, we have to engage in an analysis of the mind. And he begins with the premise. He gives pretty good arguments for it. His starting thesis is that all contents of my mind arise from impressions, just his word for sensations, right? And so everything that I know, everything that I think arises from impressions. Each sensation that I experience leaves a trace in my memory. These traces get associated with one another according to the three principles of association, connection in time and space, resemblance, and cause and effect. And this is how all the ideas in our mind are formed. And when we begin to apply this sort of principle, now we can go and look at the various concepts we have in our mind, and we can say, right, are these ideas chimeras? That is, are they fictions that are created by our minds, or do they correspond to reality as we know it? And of course, he's very hard on religion and the concept of God. Descartes had argued, how did Descartes prove the existence of God? Descartes said, look, when I look into my consciousness, I find that I have an idea in my consciousness, the idea of perfection. How did I get this idea of perfection? He says, well, I couldn't have created the idea of perfection from my imagination because I'm certainly not a perfect being. I couldn't have learned it by observing the world because nothing I see in the world around me is perfect. The only way I could have gotten this idea in my mind is from a being that has the quality of perfection, because there must be, his strange way of talking in the third meditation, must be as much reality in the effect, the idea in my mind, as the cause of that idea. So the very fact that I have the idea of perfection, according to Descartes, entails that God exists, a variation of the ontological proof for the existence of God. Well, Hume comes along, and what does Hume say? He says, no, I can tell you exactly how we get the idea of God. We introspect on our own powers, and we imagine them as being without limit, or, right, later on, Freud will give a variation of Hume's argument deriving the concept of God from experience. He says, look, you know, my concept of God is really modeled on my parents, who seem very, very strong and powerful to me. It's really something derived from experience. And Hume's argument makes a lot of sense, right? Because if Descartes were right, when we look at the world around us, what would we expect of the world religions? We would expect the world religions to have remarkable consensus about the nature of God. What do we find? That people across the world have remarkably different concepts of God, even within one and the same religion, right? People have different concepts of God. This suggests an empirical origin of that idea, which means that the idea is no longer evidence for the existence of that thing. He gives a whole critique in Book 9, Section 9 of An Inquiry Concerning Human Understanding, where he critiques the testimony of miracles, showing that this is not reliable historical evidence. All right, so we have the critique of religion in Hume, but also in Hume, what do we get? We get the critique of the basic concepts of the sciences. Right? Hume is an equal opportunity skeptic. It's not just that he's critical of this rational theology and rational psychology. It's that he's also critical of the sciences. And so what is the big crisis that Hume points out? He points out, look, right? I don't have a rational concept of causality. He says, really, my causality My concept of causality is just a habitual association of one event following another. I don't have a sensation of the necessary relationship or of one thing causing another. I just have an experience of one sensation following another. And so from the standpoint of my experience, for example, every time I take a nap, when I walk out of my room, my dog is there. One event following another. Every time I wake up in the morning, before the sun rises, I have a cup of coffee, then the sun rises. Is my drinking of the cup of coffee the cause of the sun rising? From the standpoint of consciousness, this is indistinguishable from striking a match and producing a flame. It's just one event following another. Hume says we can't give any demonstration that would distinguish between two events that merely follow one another and one event that causes another. And so what is it that's happening here with Hume? There we get the collapse of the reliability of the sciences. We say, well, how do we know there's a causal relation? All my past experience had this regularity to it, but that only shows that things were this way in the past, not that they must be that way in the future. Hume critiques the idea of substance, and of course, the concept of substance, what does it mean? It doesn't refer to matter or what something is made of, like wood. A substance is an individual thing, and so Aristotle had this idea that qualities, the properties of the thing, the color, the shape, and so on, had to inhere in a substance as the subject of predication. Hume says, look, right? Every time I look at an object, I never encounter this thing called substance. All I ever encounter is a bundle of properties. And so the concept of substance is demolished. The subject is demolished in David Hume. When I introspect, he says, what do I find? I don't find this, I think, therefore, that Descartes talked about, this soul. All I find is the stream of consciousness. And so we have a crisis here, right? You know, Hume has diagnosed these rationalists. He has undermined their arguments about the nature of physical reality and so on. But right, at the price of a thoroughgoing skepticism. The universe becomes an irrational thing based on habitual concepts in our mind rather than any sort of rational, intelligible, demonstrable knowledge. And so, you know, this is where we get Kant entering the picture. Kant says, whoa, right, there has to be something wrong here with Hume's conclusion. Hume is right to critique the rationalists, because they're all coming to different conclusions, but his skepticism is intolerable. His skepticism is intolerable. And so what Kant suggests, what Kant claims, is that we need to engage in a critique of reason to, on the one hand, account for, right, this key Kantian concept, the conditions for the possibility of certain forms of knowledge we have. And in particular, I mean, Kant just takes it as a factual matter that that we do have certain forms of knowledge. He simply refuses at the outset David Hume's skepticism. In particular, the forms of knowledge he claims that we have are mathematical knowledge. He thinks arithmetic and geometry are solid. Hume, I don't think, disagreed with that either. And on the other hand, Newtonian physics, right? He finds Newtonian physics, which of course we later on discover is mistaken, but he thinks that Newtonian physics is indisputably true. And there's something very interesting about these two forms of knowledge. Now, David Hume had argued, and the rationalists had all agreed with him. Am I boring you guys to pieces? Okay, I'm talking a lot, right? Trying to compose.
I like the refresher.
Okay, and so David Hume had argued that our mathematical concepts were what Kant later on would call analytic a priori judgments. And when we talk about a judgment being analytic, right, we're basically just saying that the judgment is true by definition, right? And so if I say that all bachelors are unmarried males, right, unmarried male is just a synonym of the term bachelor. And so nobody is going to say, you know, nobody's going to go to the NEH, the National Endowment of the Humanities, and propose a sociological study to investigate all bachelors on the planet Earth to see whether or not, in fact, they are unmarried males, because it's just the definition of a bachelor to be an unmarried male. And Hume said mathematics is like this. All the judgments of mathematics are analytic a priori judgments. On the other hand, we have the synthetic, and these analytic a posteriori or a priori judgments aren't, they're nothing, perhaps, right? We'll just say there's nothing mysterious about them, with deference to Quine, who calls all of that into question later on, but for the purposes of our story, we won't get to that. When we have other forms of judgment, such as the judgment Selma has blonde hair, right, that is a synthetic a posteriori judgment. With a synthetic a posteriori judgment, there isn't a mystery here either, right? I couldn't have analyzed my concept of Selma, right, when I saw her name on a piece of paper and deduced from that concept that she would have blonde hair. I had to actually experience her, and my mind synthesizes these two things with one another, forming a new bit of knowledge. And so analytic a priori knowledge, it doesn't expand my knowledge at all. Synthetic a posteriori knowledge expands my knowledge. I learn something new when I meet Daniel, or when I see that baking soda fizzes up when it's mixed with vinegar. My knowledge is expanded in these sorts of cases. Kant says, no, there's a third kind of knowledge. This is the famous synthetic a priori knowledge. They are a really remarkable thing when you think about it, these synthetic a priori judgments. These are judgments that are independent of experience. I don't have to observe the thing in order to know them, but nonetheless, they are, Kant's terminology, ampliative. They expand my knowledge. And so somehow, through the process of thinking alone, through my thought, not my observation of the world, I am able to expand my knowledge. It's like magic, right? It seems to violate, right, the law of conservation of matter and energy, where you can't get more in an effect that was there in the cause through thought alone. Somehow I am amplifying my knowledge of the world. And this is where he pitches his flag. And he's very clever, right? Like so many philosophers before him, he appeals to mathematics. And what does he say in the case of mathematics? He says, look, you know, Hume and all these rationalists said that these mathematical judgments, the one that he harps on again and again, 7 plus 5 equals 12, they said these were analytic truths, like the judgment that a bachelor is an unmarried male. But no, when I do mathematics, I learn more when I get to the conclusion that 7 plus 5 equals 12 than I had to begin with. My mind is somehow synthesizing two concepts and producing more than was in my mind already. And so the question is, and of course we have the question, if this were a course on Kant, is Kant right, right? Later on, the analytic philosophers would vehemently disagree with them on this thesis that mathematics is synthetic in this way. They would try and make good on the thesis that it's analytic. But, and there are all sorts of reasons for that. But, you know, is Kant right that mathematical reasoning is synthetic? It seems, right, that he might be right here, right? Because it does seem, right, when, especially if you think about very large numbers, if you think about long, complex chains of reasoning in geometry, it seems like we learn things that surprise us from the armchair, right? You know, why is it that we don't find geniuses in biology, 16-year-old kids that are revolutionary thinkers in biology, but we find them in mathematics? Well, biology takes a lot of reading and observation and experience, whereas math is something you can do through your thought alone. There's something magical here. And so Kant's question is, how are synthetic a priori judgments possible? How is it that we are able to do this? And he thinks that there are similar things in the sciences with Newton when we make a claim such as every effect has a cause and so on and so forth. A whole series of root-level claims in physics that we don't that precede experience, that are about all of experience, and that aren't derived from experience. His claims are more contentious here. How is it possible that we're able to do this in the case of physics? And so this is what's called quid facti dimension of Kantian critique. Quid facti, it is just a matter of fact that, right, according to Kant, these mathematical judgments in geometry and arithmetic are synthetic a priori, that they amplify our knowledge, that they're independent of experience. The question of the critical project becomes quid juris, right? What must things be like in order for this to be possible? Right, the key Kantian question. Right, and Kant says, we're all familiar with the Kantian move. You know, Kant says, look, if I think that my mind is like a wax tablet in the way that Hume had described it, where there's nothing inside of my mind, that my mind is this passive thing and there's nothing inside of it until it comes in through my five senses, I can never explain how I can know a priori that at all places in the universe, it has to be the case that the square of the hypotenuse is equal to the sum of the square of the other two sides for right triangles, or that all triangles have angles that add up to 180 degrees, right? Or that parallel lines never meet. Experience can't explain that. And why can't experience explain the properties of necessity and universality that apply to these sorts of propositions? Because I don't experience everything in the universe, past, present, and future throughout space. Right, I couldn't establish this. And so he says, it can't be that my mind, as he puts it, conforms to the world around me. Mind, this is his revolutionary idea, has to be this active thing that structures reality. Time and space aren't something that I learn through my five senses. They are a priori forms of sensation, or his word for it, intuition, that mind imposes on reality. And so what we're really doing when we do mathematics, when we do geometry and arithmetic, is we are exploring these forms of sensibility that our mind imposes upon the world. We're like a turtle, right? The turtle takes its home everywhere it goes. We take space and time everywhere that it goes, right? And the reason that the objects of nature have this mathematical structure, that it works out for them, is because my mind is structuring that natural world in terms of these categories of space and time. And then with the sciences, we get the categories of the understanding that the mind imposes on the world, and we get all of the various syntheses that take place here. And so the price of this Kantian move, right, he's able to preserve the necessity and universality of science. At least he makes the claim. I'm a little bit more skeptical as to whether or not he's actually understood fully the nature of the problem. But the Kant has preserved the necessity and universality of the sciences by arguing that reality conforms to the mind rather than the mind conforming to reality, and we find out this sort of fulfillment of the Enlightenment ideal, we turn out to be the ones that are calling the shots. This really remarkable thing. But the price is we can't have knowledge of the things as they are in themselves. And so having built this apparatus that I'm going through very quickly, the next move becomes to explain why in metaphysics mind endlessly ends up in this series of problems that led Spinoza, Leibniz, Descartes to arrive at different conclusions from one another. And he discovers this remarkable thing, and this is one of the key concepts we want to take away from Kant as we approach Deleuze and Guattari. He discovers, right, where perhaps many previous philosophers, I won't say all previous philosophers, for them the problem was error. All right, you know, I see Michael here, and I say to Michael, good morning, Selma. All right, there's a failed correspondence between the being that exists out there in the world, Michael, and my belief or my statement about the being. the main thing that we have to avoid is falsehoods. Kant discovers a much more profound sort of error that is internal to the nature of reason alone, right? And there are three types of these errors that exist in Kant. There are what he calls paralogisms, which Deleuze in the Nietzsche book, as well as in Anti-Oedipus, makes a lot out of. Paralogisms are this ineluctable tendency that we have in our thought to treat the mind, to treat ourself or the soul as a substance. And this is the interesting thing about Kant. We can't avoid falling into these sorts of errors. And so it's almost inevitable, right, that we're going to treat the I think as a substance, but nonetheless, it's based on a fallacious sort of reasoning that is internal to the nature of reason itself. And then there are reasonings that pertain to the nature of the world. This would be the four antinomies. So we have paralogisms, we have antinomies, right? And so there's something internal to reason that leads to these antinomies. There are four of them in all. One of the antinomies applies to the either finitude or infinitude of the universe. Another antinomy applies to whether or not things are infinitely divisible, right, as Baidu is saying today. This is noteworthy, right? Or whether or not there are, as the Greek atomist said, indivisible units out of which things are composed. We make arguments for either one of these positions that are absolutely compelling. The third one has to do with freedom. And so, does everything have a necessary cause to it, or is there a cause that originates out of itself without arising from the preceding causes? And I always forget what the fourth one is, so you'll have to beg my pardon for that. And then finally, we have the ideas which pertain to God. And so we have rational... is internal to reason that pertain to the nature of the subject, the self, or the soul. We have ideas pertaining to the world, and that's the antinomies, and ideas pertaining to God. And it is to Kant's great merit, right, to have both explained how mind falls into these three forms of dialectical reasoning, but he doesn't simply point out that that say these antinomies or these ideas of the soul, he doesn't simply point out that they're wrong or they're mistaken. What he shows in addition to this is what sort of function they serve within reason. Right, he thinks, look, if reason is inevitably everywhere and always, and that might be a contentious claim, if reason is everywhere and always led to fall into these kinds of illusions, they're not simple errors, there must be some function, right, to these three ideas. And he gives us an account of what function these ideas serve. And so what I want to suggest with respect to Deleuze and Guattari along an analogous line of reasoning is that when they critique Oedipus, right, this isn't, you know, I see a lot of readers of Anti-Oedipus and of Deleuze and Guattari that see Oedipus as a kind of stupidity or as a sort of error that psychoanalysts make, right? But there seems to be, and we're going to have to add additional bells and whistles to account for this, there seems to be something internal to social existence itself, to how we think about the nature of the world and how we experience others around us, that lead to this structure that I'm calling Oedipus. All right, now, I think a major difference between Kant and Deleuze and Guattari on this sort of point is where Kant seems to think that these illusions of reason are kind of eternal structures of any rational mind capable of doing mathematics and physical science, They will be everywhere and always. And, you know, just to let the cat out of the bag with Kant, the reason we have these ideas is because reason, you know, it's this beautiful thing in Kant's philosophy. There's this kind of unrest reason. Right, and so the ideas of the understanding, they make simple judgments, and they give us something like a dictionary or an encyclopedia of knowledge, right? And so you can pick it up, and understanding, what Kant calls understanding, it'll tell you about all the facts pertaining to aardvarks, right? All of the facts pertaining to the properties of zinc, and so on and so forth. But they will all be disconnected from one another. Right, it's just like a list of things, not unlike the list that that Foucault speaks of at the beginning of The Order of Things, right? From a, I think he says it's a Chinese encyclopedia, and you're like, well, what is the question that reason asks us? What is it that reason adds to understanding? Reason says, what is the whole? What is the systematic order? It's always drawing us forward to figure out how things fit together in a system. So reason strives after systematicity. It doesn't like trivia that you might play at the bar to amuse yourself on a Thursday night or something like that. It wants a systematic structure of knowledge that assigns a place to everything, a purpose to everything. And so these ideas that are constantly exceeding the limits of experience are actually the sort of unrest of reason that are perpetually drawing us to systematize things in the world around us. Right? My idea of the soul, of myself as a substance, is, right, even if when I introspect, I can't find anywhere inside of myself the I equals I that constitutes the Levi-ness of Levi, nonetheless, and Michael, you know, I think you might enjoy this, right? Just like with Heidegger, there is this unrest within myself to define what my life project is, how all these elements of my experience fit together in defining the who-ness of who I am. And it's a tragedy at the same time. It will never accomplish it once and for all, right? But nonetheless, I'm constantly drawn to unify things, to systematize things, even at the level of my identity. In the case of God, right, God is the search for an ultimate ground or reason in all of the phenomena of the universe, right? And so it's not that I have knowledge of God, it's that the idea of God is constantly drawing me on to do these sorts of things. And we find why reason has this sort of vocation in the second critique. It turns out that reason's ultimate vocation is moral in character. It is practical in character, but we won't talk about that right now. A major difference in the case of Deleuze and Guattari, I think, is that while historically, and I think this is a vexed issue that we encountered last time, whether or not this is the case, how Kantian are Deleuze and Guattari. And so we saw something that looked rather Kantian when Deleuze and Guattari talked about the nature of the state. You know, they disagreed with a number of historians and anthropologists who argue that the state is something that historically came into existence because things like agriculture were achieved, and this led to all sorts of exigencies. And their argument following, who is it that they're always citing? Why am I? Archaeology of Violence.
What is the Pierre Clastres.
Yeah. Huh?
Clastres. Pierre Clastres.
Yeah, Clastres. Right. Right. They argue that there is this er-state thing, which sounds like an a priori state. That sounds like a very Kantian idea, this illusion of sociality that perpetually haunts the social, right? You know, they make the claim the state was never invented. It just comes into existence in a variety of different ways, and the nomad is this sort of war, this series of mechanisms trying to ward off the state in some way or another, to prevent the state from actualizing itself or coming into to existence. But you know, the whole question here is how does desire become Oedipal? How does desire become fascist? How does desire take on the structure of ontotheology or the state? All right, and so, you know, and Freud is very clear on this point, right? If you read Freud's Civilization and its Discontents and other texts besides, what is it that Freud says? Freud says that if you want to know what the unconscious is, go and talk to the schizophrenic. The schizophrenic tells you what the unconscious is, shows you what the unconscious is in its pure form, right? Because the mechanism of repression isn't operative, according to the Freudian theory, the Lacanian theory, in repression or in schizophrenia. Right, and they take this very seriously because the schizophrenic, well, they are without identity, right? Their desire isn't based on lack. It appears to be connective, right? A major claim that they're going to make in the Transcendental Aesthetic of Anti-Oedipus, Chapter 1, that desire is connective rather than repressive or based on lack. And so we have this whole question, if desire is basically schizophrenic, as Freud argued, at the level of the unconscious, how does it take on this Oedipal structure? Right? That's part of what they're trying to account for, I think. How does it become Oedipalized? This isn't, right, the natural or the inevitable state. This is the result of some set of syntheses. And they're going to argue in the second chapter of Anti-Oedipus that there are a series of paralogisms that lead to the formation of the Oedipus in this way. And so, you know, let's see. Do we want to take a break for a moment and come back to this, or do we want to plunge on ahead with the story?
Taking a break wouldn't be a bad idea, at least from my point of view. What other people say?
How about the rest of you? A break or?
Either way is fine with me.
Okay. Yeah, let's take a break.
Yeah, I mean this is a lot. So, all right. So I'll be let's say 10 minutes, quarter after, and we'll jump back into things. I'll give you the punchline. I hope. So hopefully we can begin to filter back. Actually, I'm going to grab a glass of water real quick. I'll be right back.
Critique of Pure Reason sitting here, and I just double checked out of curiosity. The fourth antinomy is the one on the necessary being.
Mm. Yeah, so almost kind of a launching point into the three ideas, the proofs for the existence of God.
Yeah.
There is no necessary being, there is a necessary being.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, do we have any questions or remarks? Hopefully, before we jump back.
Where online are the lectures, like for the recordings?
Jason? Not sure if you're there or not.
They're on you have like a page in the News Center. Like a profile page, and if you go to your profile page at thenewcenter.org, they're on that page.
Okay, like all new center students have it, or
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry, what was the question exactly?
Oh, just where the lectures are. That's all.
Oh, like, yeah, what? Yeah, yeah. You have to log in with your New Center email and password.
I don't think I have a New Center email.
Okay, yeah, we need to get you squared away.
Okay, thanks. All right, cool.
Okay, so any points of clarification, remarks, observations?
Yeah, I have a sort of a question. So this kind of like, how does Deleuze calls it, like legislative system of thought based on judgments that Kant produces, in which sense is it, let's say, fundamentally different from rationalism or from the whole system that tries to reproduce material reality through thought? I mean, I believe it tries to like produce objects through ideas. That might be like one of the main differences, but I can't seem to find like a, you know, like a major twist or a major, I don't know, difference between both, let's say, traditions.
Yeah, I mean, and Kant is generally seen as a sort of synthesis of the rationalist and the empiricist. And so the key difference for Kant is that the only legitimate employment of categories of the understanding in mind is in relation to experience or sensibility, right? And so there are 12 categories in all in the Critique of Pure Reason, and what is it? Quantity, quality, relation, and then there are three under each one of these, and mode. And the rationalists, what the rationalists thought that they could do is that they could reason from and operate with these concepts alone, independent of sensation, intuition, or experience. And this is why they're able to come to opposing conclusions in something like the antinomy. For Kant, the only legitimate employment is in relation to actual experience. And so with the rationalists, Kant would argue that there is an a priori concept of substance, but that the use of that concept of substance, we can only reason from it in relation to sensations that are given to us in our intuition. Does that answer your question? And so it's when reason goes beyond the bounds or the limits of experience that it falls into problems. Now, you know, it's Deleuze, of course, in the piece that Jason shared with all of you, K is for Kant from the dialogues with Claire Parnay, I think, or is that the ABCs of Gilles Deleuze? Is that's where that's coming from? There, where Deleuze talks about having done with judgment, in this legislative use of reason. I mean, he makes these wonderful observations, and it's probably, Daniel, something that we should try and figure out. He makes this wonderful observation about his methodological approach, that he tries to think of concepts as characters, right? Almost like in some sort of a drama or a story or something like that. And I forget, what does he say for the rationalist? The character is for the rationalist concept. Does he talk about the investigator?
Yeah, I think so.
For the rationalist. And then with Kant, we get this extraordinary character of the judge, of the tribunal of reason. And so reason becomes a sort of tribunal. But, you know, I find that Deleuze's relationship to Kant is deeply ambivalent, right? And so, you know, one of the things that we're going to find when we get to Anti-Oedipus is that desire is creative. It produces its own objects, and we're going to have to figure out what that might mean to produce objects in some way or another. Well, this is a very Kantian idea in the Critique of Practical Reason. Desire is somehow producing its object there in the Critique of Practical Reason. And then he has a great deal of praise, which is a subject that fascinates me deeply, for the Kant of the Third Critique, right? Because in the Kant of the Third Critique, you know, the Kant of the First Critique, things are straightforward when we talk about judgment. We have a general concept, we know exactly what that concept is about, and we're simply subsuming a particular underneath that concept. But what the Third Critique is dealing with is situations where we encounter things for which we don't have a concept yet, right? And so the Critique of Judgment is this analysis of this sort of crucible, or this forge of mind that is producing new concepts. And of course, this is something that couldn't fail to delight Deleuze in a variety of ways, right? This creative moment where the imagination is emphasized over the understanding and of subsumption. Kant seems to be escaping from, at this moment, without quite hitting that point, the constraints of his own system. He seems to himself be moving beyond judgment in the more pejorative sense of the term that Deleuze seems to be talking about. Now, I haven't read the Artaud that he's referring to there. Has anybody read the Artaud and maybe could say a few words about that?
Yeah, I've read that to have done with the judgment of God. I would need to go back and look at my notes. I'm trying to remember. But this is one of the places where... this is where bodies without organs was actually stated by Artaud himself in this text. And so they basically took this concept out of Artaud, how to make oneself a body without organs. So kind of the judgment of God part of it, I think, is I'm not really sure what more to add to that without going back and looking at my notes, actually.
All right. Other remarks, other thoughts?
Just in terms of what you were saying, Levi, about the schizophrenic as sort of pure unconscious.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's an interesting connection. I'm not sure exactly what it means, but it seems like there's something to sort of the, the romanticization of like psychosis and of mental illness, mm-hmm. and the idea of it as being pure unconscious. I don't have any sort of great insights into that, but I definitely think there's some relationship to sort of the desire for sort of the sort of kind of like pure unmediated contents of like the psyche to just sort of, or maybe even the psyche is not even the right, but of just to just sort of be all open and present. And of course it, that never really works out when that actually happens for someone, but
Yeah, and I think that after writing Anti-Oedipus, Deleuze and Guattari worried about this sort of romanticization of the unconscious. There, the significance of the schizophrenic in certain ways is that it just shows us on the surface, right, the mechanisms of how the unconscious works. And so, one of the things that, we find out if we read Freud's project essay is that the unconscious is without lack, right? It's a series of, the way he describes it in this unpublished essay, out of which his model of the unconscious will emerge. He describes it as these energetic disequilibriums, right, that form relations and sever relations. There's no lack within it, right? It's always some sort of pure positivity in some way or another. It is connective, it is synthetic, it is creative. It doesn't obey the principle of negation, which would follow from it being without lack. It doesn't obey the principle of non-contradiction. It is without identity, and so something that Deleuze is already going to be emphasizing in things like in Nietzsche and philosophy with respect to his reading of The Eternal Return is how I am all the names in history. Right, there's this way in which, right, we are already, according to this sort of logic, plural in certain ways, and this will come up again and again in Anti-Oedipus. And so, the sort of question that we're going to get is, if the unconscious has these sorts of characteristics, it's the question that they draw out of Spinoza on the one hand, and the very eccentric psychoanalytic theorist Wilhelm Reich on the other hand. How is it, right, if desire is affirmative and without lack, and if it is always sort of leaking around the edges and connecting to things outside of itself, how do we come to desire our own repression or oppression? How does this take place? What are the mechanisms by which this comes into being? And Similarly, in the earlier book, Nietzsche and Philosophy, we get the question, how does desire become nihilistic, right? If the essence of being is to be affirmative, how is it that desire comes to turn in on itself and to will, as it were, its own destruction? And so they're trying to give an account of this. So in Nietzsche and Philosophy, we are going to get a couple of things out of that book, just to bring everything home. On the one hand, they think that Kant didn't go far enough in his project of critique. He didn't call into question the established values upon which this critique was based. And so there needs to be a critique of values themselves, how values are generated, how they come to be, but also how does desire become nihilistic, right? He seems to think, following Nietzsche, that the history of philosophy is this sort of march of nihilism. How does that take place? What are the dynamics of that process? How does something that is active and affirmative turn against itself? And in Anti-Oedipus, right, we're going to get the question, which is very similar to the Nietzschean question, how is it that we come to desire our own oppression, right? As if it were our salvation, I think, is the way that the Reich puts it. And so, you know, there...
And not to be, like, too much of a smartass, but it's been a question that's sort of really been on my mind this election season. It's the extent to which people seem to be desiring their own oppression in the United States. So it's definitely relevant to today.
Well, and that's exactly the sort of thing that they're talking about, right, where, you know, they say the real mystery isn't why do people steal, why do people, you know, break up the machines, why do people, you know, kill each other and everything. They say the real mystery is, why don't people do this more often and all the time, right? You know, why is it that we don't revolt against these sorts of things? And so we have a couple of different answers to this question. You know, we have the Marxist answer to this question, that it is ideology. And if we want to take a very vulgar conception of what ideology is, that ideology is distorted views or distorted beliefs about the social world that benefit, right, whatever the ruling group is. And so I have some sort of mistaken conception, and I think this is the problem, and I begin fighting on behalf of those things and against those things, when in fact the real problem, the real cause of these things is elsewhere. I think, you know, if I'm a follower of Trump, I think that it is illegal immigrants that are the reason that my society is collapsing and that I don't have a job and that I'm not paid well, you know, all these sorts of things, when in fact it's the mechanisms of capitalism, right, and the way in which capitalism is both structured and contaminates the system that produces these sorts of things. Well, the problem with the ideological answer, you know, as Sloterdijk, pointed out a little while ago, so this would have been after all of the stuff with Deleuze and Guattari, is that, you know, and I'm not sure that this is in fact true, but the idea seems to be in his critique of cynical reason that we are somehow, in a sense, beyond ideology, in the sense that we all know, right, that the stuff that we see in the news and that the politicians talk about and these nationalisms and everything is a lie. We're all cynical of these sorts of things, but we still keep participating in the system in the same way that we did before, right? You know, it's, we know that this is a facade, yet we still keep doing it, right? And, you know, Sloterdijk in that book, I guess, tries to argue that cynicism, or maybe this is Zizek building on Sloterdijk, that cynicism is the new figure of ideology, but how is it that we can be aware that these are the problems and still allow this these sorts of social structures to persist? I think that for Deleuze and Guattari themselves, if memory serves me correctly, Anti-Oedipus was written in 1972 within the wake of May of 68, the revolution that took place in France, and you know, there, the mystery was, is here we have the French Communist Party that doesn't jump in and support the student and worker protesters. They should be, they should be free of ideology in a certain way, yet they don't participate in this revolution. What is going on here? Ideology doesn't seem to account for this. A second answer is the sort of Foucauldian answer, right, that we get. And so for Foucault, the answer is power. We internalize power in some way or another, almost like a sort of conditioning. So on the one hand, we internalize the panopticon. On the other hand, there's the whole discussion of docile bodies and discipline and punish, where we go through a disciplinary regime that forms us in a certain way to have certain dispositions and certain behaviors. And then finally, Deleuze and Guattari's answer is desire, right? They say, no, right? You know, the reason we do these sorts of things is because of desire. And we're going to have to figure out what they mean by that. But there's just this wonderful passage in Anti-Oedipus where they're talking about the bureaucrat that maybe works in an office somewhere here in the United States. It would be the Department of Motor Vehicles, right? And or maybe it would be the bureaucrat that works for a health insurance company. And you know, you go to this person, and what they point out is that the bureaucrat is libidinally invested in what they do. They're actually getting off on, right, this is the dimension of desire, they're getting off on the filing system, right, and the little red and blue and yellow dots that they put on the edges of the folders, the forms and the procedures. It's libidinal, right? And so it's not enough simply to critique ideology, right? We might get very far by critiquing ideology. I don't think it's necessarily an either-or thing here, but we also have to get at this level of desire that libidinally invests, right? Libidinally invests these things and gets off on them. He says, just look at any Nazi rally. They were getting off on the flags, on the marching, on the uniforms, on the torches, and all of these sorts of things. There's a dimension of libido here. And so how is it that libido, or how is it that desire comes to invest things in these sorts of ways? What is a fascist desire, and where does this come from, and what strategies can we develop to move away from these sorts of sad passions?
I wanted, sorry, Levi, just to throw the quote in that you were referencing for everybody if they want to read the reference.
Yeah, it's one of my favorite passages.
Yeah, I love that one.
Yeah. And so that is really all I have to say tonight. And so if we want to move on to discussion, that's fine. But I think I've reached the limit of my ability to hold forth.
And so, I was just going to ask a sort of a brief question about they sort of end on what do they call the chapter? From aesthetics to teleology. And I'm wondering if you can just say something about that shift towards teleology. I'm wondering if it's like a movement away from ontological claims, which might be, I guess, more like identity focused in describing what is, and teleology as like a directedness or a nomadedness in like that movement, I guess.
Are you talking about in Kant's critical philosophy?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, and so this is a long story. And as I understand it, what's going on here in the Critique of Judgment, the reason that that Kant is exploring aesthetic judgment is because aesthetic objects, artistic objects, are this privileged case of reflective judgments, where the object doesn't have a concept for it, right, but sort of spurs our understanding on to search for a concept of it. And so we're witnessing in aesthetic judgment the pursuit of a concept that would be adequate to that object, right? And so really, you know, the problem that Kant seems to be dealing with here is what later Charles Sanders Peirce would be dealing with under the, if I understand him correctly, under the concept of abduction, right? We have induction, where you generalize from a variety of cases. You have deduction, where you subsume a particular under a more general concept. And you have abduction, which is the formation for the first time of this sort of concept. And how does this take place, right? It's this deeply mysterious thing of how concept formation takes place. And so with the aesthetic object, and we might disagree with some of the claims that Kant is making here, the aesthetic object has four, according to the four categories, it has four qualities to it. One of the qualities is, right, and so when we make the judgment that the opera is beautiful, or that the flower is beautiful, or something like that, we attribute what Kant calls a subjective universality to it, right? And of course, all of us are probably going to say beauty is in the eye of the beholder, but if we look at what we actually do in practice with judgments of beauty, we claim a certain universality for them. We expect, right, others to agree with us about this judgment. And we behave about them in a way that's different than the way we behave towards cauliflower. And so if you and I, Theodore, were to get in, were to say, well, I love cauliflower. It actually doesn't taste like much of anything to me. It's like the water of vegetables. And you say, I hate cauliflower, right? It would be very strange for us to get in a discussion or a debate about cauliflower, because it's just a matter of agreeableness, right? You know, I guess, you know, it's been shown that a certain percentage of the population has a certain gene that makes cauliflower and broccoli taste absolutely vile to them. It tastes like vomit. And, you know, it's just the way in which you or I experience cauliflower. There's no debate about it. But with artistic objects, right, you know, we get in debates about these things. It's a really interesting thing about these aesthetic judgments, is if we could persuade the other person to see that object as beautiful, as if we can produce reasons for these things. And so it has the quality of universality, it has the quality of necessity, right, that it's necessarily the case for all people. He says that aesthetic judgments are disinterested, and it's easy to get confused about this quality of disinterestedness in the Kantian theory of aesthetics, right? What he's talking about when he talks about disinterestedness, to put it rather crudely, is to say we don't want to eat the play, right? You know, and so at the level of sensual gratification, it's not like food or a sexual object that is the nature of our appreciation, where we wish to possess the thing or to consume the thing or gratify ourselves in some way. It's a sort of, and it's not like a tool that, and I think this is one of the wonderful things about beauty and art, it's not like a tool that serves some sort of purpose in the sense that we appreciate it because it solves world hunger or increases workplace efficiency or helps us with our health, right? We don't appreciate it because of its utility. And in addition to that, with respect to practical reason or moral reasoning, we don't appreciate the beauty of the artwork because it conveys some sort of a moral lesson or that it edifies us morally. It can, of course, do that, right? But that is sort of parasitic or tangential to its being as an aesthetic object. It's something that is appreciated for its own sake. And, you know, I think with respect to this quality here, I think in a strange way, Nietzsche later on is, even though he's carrying out this profound critique of Kant, is in some ways pretty very appreciative of Kantian aesthetics, because here in the case of something like beauty, we find something that is valuable for its own sake that doesn't refer to any sort of transcendent otherworldly justification, right? And so if we can make our life into a work of art, right, this might be a way of overcoming nihilism that's valuable for its own sake without having to appeal to transcendent Platonic forms to justify existence or some sort of reward in heaven or some sort of eschatology where society will overcome alienation once and for all, that sort of thing. And what is the fourth? Universality, necessity, it's disinterested. I seem to be forgetting the fourth one of everything today. I'm going to have to go and talk to a schizoanalyst to figure out what that symptom is all about. The most important one of all, it's purposive. Without a purpose that is determinate, right? And so the things of beauty, they seem to indicate some sort of intentionality to them, right? But we can't figure out what it is, right? And so judgments of beauty, they are what Kant calls these reflective judgments. They are judgments that are in search of a concept, and they prepare the way, this is what Deleuze says anyway in his reading, they prepare the way for teleological judgments, right, which is the second form of reflective judgment, in the sense that they acquaint us with this purposiveness, but they don't yet give us a determinate purpose, right? And so with the teleological judgment, what's going on, if I understand correctly what he's talking about, is that now, right, we're looking at nature as a whole in terms of speculative reason, and in order to comprehend nature at all, he says, we can never know whether or not it's really this case, the case for nature itself, but in order to comprehend nature at all, we have to think about it in terms of teleology, or the way in which everything serves ends for everything else in a system, right? And so, you know, and we see this, if you study an organism, right, in studying the organism, what is the Darwinian who doesn't believe in teleology at all, right? That was one of Darwin's major achievements. What is the evolutionary biologist, how does he approach the organism? He says, look, every quality, every property of its phenotype, of its body that the organism has to serve some sort of purpose with respect to either the environment around that organism, right? It must have conferred some sort of an advantage, or with respect to how the different parts of the organism are put together. I have to think in terms of what is, right, you know, we as human beings, what do we have? We have a tail. Right, you can't see it, unlike our primate ancestors. Why is it that we have an appendix? Why is it that we have tails when this doesn't serve any sort of power, purpose or teleology? And in order to account for that, they immediately go, well, in our ancestors, right? We must have been descended from ancestors that somehow used this organ in some way for those ends. And then as we think about organisms in relationship to one another, we have to think about nature teleologically in terms of how you have these hierarchical systems in which it's not just that the knee bone connects to the leg bone and the leg bone connects to the hip bone, but that the iris connects to, or the orchid connects to the wasp, and the wasp connects to this, and that connects to that, and that connects to that, in a system of purposes forming an overarching ecology, right? And so teleological judgment is this dimension of speculation, which in Kant means the study of nature, that is looking for a systematic whole and the function that all of these parts serve in relation to one another, as I understand it. And I'm certainly no Kant scholar, so.
Great, that was a really good summary. Yeah, I guess I was wondering how that might relate to state structures, but that's sort of far away, guys.
Yeah, and I mean, that's a good question. Let's see if I can find it here.
Yeah, I guess, sort of correct me if I'm wrong, but like, generally, ontology is thought to be an inquiry into, or maybe a rational inquiry into what is being, and if teleological is, it's similar in a way that it tries to describe directedness or purposiveness, but it's not necessarily locked into a single identity, because it has to confront immanence. Does that make sense?
Okay, so what you said, ontology is generally the investigation of what is versus, what was the second one? I'm sorry.
Teleology as, it's similar to an investigation of what is, but it's a investigation into directedness or purposiveness.
Yeah, I mean, it would be an ontological question as to whether or not existence has purposiveness to it or not, right? You know, right. Is there purposiveness within nature? And this is a metaphysical thesis. And so, you know, for Kant, as a sort of critic of metaphysics, you know, where somebody like Leibniz, right, you know, Leibniz, he asked the question, why did God create this universe rather than all of the other possible universes that God could have existed or created? And in a manner that makes Voltaire's jaw drop, right? What does he say? He says, God created this universe because it's the best of all possible universes. And so Leibniz is going to end up with a highly teleological conception of existence, because now we have to ask the question, well, and of course God couldn't do otherwise, right? You know, if God is by definition a perfect being, well, just like we would think about, you know, a good car designer, right? What makes the Germans or the Japanese great car designers, right, is every part is put together in the best possible way or something like that of the car. Well, God, as a perfect being, has to be the ultimate craftsman, right? He can't slack off on the job and create a universe that is better or worse than the best possible universe that could exist. And so we ask Leibniz the question, well, what is it that makes this the best of all possible universes? He says that this is the universe that has, how does he put it? It's the universe that has the simplest possible laws, right? And so he's obsessed with calculus. He thinks that no matter how random a series of points looks, you can find an equation to describe the order in which those dots occurred, and, right, that explains each curve and permutation. And so it has the simplest possible laws with the greatest amount of variety. That has to be a testament to God's infinity. As a being, And he says it's the universe, and this is the real hard one to get your head around. It's the universe that affords us the greatest opportunity to morally perfect ourselves or achieve happiness. And you're like, holy shit, when you hear this, right? Seriously? To achieve happiness in this universe? But, you know, if you ask Leibniz, well, you know, why did I get gangrene in my leg and have to have my leg amputated? Why was my child killed by a drunk driver or something like that? He would say, again, he would make this appeal to teleology. He would say, somehow, right, while taken in isolation, this might appear to be imperfect, somehow this event contributed to this being the best of all possible universes. The universe in which you didn't lose your leg wouldn't be as good as a universe in which you do lose your leg. And maybe it's because, you know, it fills you with a desire to become an evangelist for medical safety and sanitary practices so people don't get an infection. Maybe you were a football player, a soccer player, and if you hadn't lost your leg, you wouldn't have gone on to get a degree in medicine and cure cancer or something like that. But everything in Leibniz's universe has a purpose to it. It's a teleological universe. It's not just one stupid thing happening after another. Whereas when you talk about somebody like Lucretius, the great Roman atomist, in a Lucretian universe, we just have cause and effect relationships. There's no purpose to things. There's no teleology. It's not the ends that are causing the means. Right? It's just one dumb thing following another dumb thing. And Kant is making the claim that, look, right, you know, in order to study nature at all, we have to think in terms of the function of things. How do things functionally relate to one another? And certainly, this is a certain model of state thinking, right? You know, if we were to bring Adorno and Horkheimer into it, right, this would be what would they call the reason, right, where everything in the state, this would be the fascist state par excellence, as Deleuze and Guattari describe it in A Thousand Plateaus, where everything serves the function or the purpose of the war machine, or we might think about the Spartan state as well as being this, where the sort of absolute state would be the subordination of everything to a sort of overarching purposiveness without remainder.
Thanks.
Other remarks, comments?
Eva, let me just ask.
Say,
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Sorry. No, I think this is a really good, at least for me, good thing to think about in terms of desire and the place of desire and this type of very determinate purpose state, absolute state, which is perhaps, I mean, also revealing of Deleuze and Guattari's conception of desire.
Yeah, and like, I'm embarrassed to admit it, Selma, but my partner and I, we have been watching this sort of reality television show about the Dallas Cowboy cheerleaders lately. Right, and it's about these women. Right, every year they compete with one another to try and get selected to become Dallas Cowboy cheerleaders. And it's like watching a horrifying spectacle, right? Because they become very mechanical. They all kick their legs in rhythm with each other, and they all move their bodies exactly alike, and they develop the same hairstyles, and they all want to dress alike. And, of course, the whole purpose is to cheer on the team in certain ways and everything. And, you know, the sort of question that we can ask ourselves here with respect to teleology and desire and all these sorts of things is, how do we develop the desire to either march in lockstep with you know, in an army, or to be a group of cheerleaders that all move in exactly the same way. And when we develop this sort of desire for sameness or identity, which that really is, when we reduce ourselves to being some sort of gear in an overarching machine, well, what are the sort of, in Lacanian terms, right, what are the sort of consequences of that, right? You know, because there has to, of course, you know, if desire is moving all over the place and connective, if it's schizophrenic, like they argue, well, to form an identity, right, like the soldier or the somebody who, like in American Psycho, I just want to be normal, I just want to be like everybody else, the character says in American Psycho, or like these cheerleaders, well, it's not as if that desire disappears that's leaking out all over the place. It's still there at odds with the attempt to form some sort of identity, and the suggestion seems to be that it becomes this very baleful, persecuting sort of thing within us, right? That might generate, I don't know, you know, for lack of a better word, all these sorts of destructive, both to ourselves and perhaps the world around us, pathological states. I don't know if that's a good example or not.
Not as an amusing example, but basically, I mean, it's not a metamorphosis, but it metastasizes, basically. I mean, the cells, to put it as simply as I can, like the cells that, the body cells, or that won't die. And as a consequence of that, we get cancer. So in a matter of speaking, that's also, I mean, a type of desire.
Yeah, I love that example, right? I mean, we could think about the formation of a sort of cancerous desire, right? That, like you say, metastasizes, and it becomes a symptom that is almost undead in a certain way that maybe accompanies these things, and a cancer. And so, right, that you know, in Artaud's terms, right, a cancer, and I don't mean to treat cancer lightly at all, a cancer is a sort of a revolt of the cells against the body, right? You know, it's a refusal to obey the totality of the body in a certain way, and of course that's very destructive for the person. But, you know, we can also think of certain cancerous desires at the additional level that are kind of these sad passions that people have, these compulsions to repeat that people suffer from, that are a revolt against identity, identification, right, and alienation in the leader or the state or the party or something like that. And so what do we do about that? Michael, did you have a remark?
Yeah, so on the nature of desire, you know, I've thought a lot lately about, I think I mentioned it last time, about, you know, the different concepts of desire, where with Lacan it's based on a lack, you know, you lack objet A and lost jouissance, and, you know, D and G end up with this productive concept of desire. And, you know, it seems as if one, okay, desire is primarily negative. On the other hand, it's primarily positive. But, you know, I've been thinking, like, about ways to maybe reconcile might not be the right word, but to incorporate the great insights both of Lacan and D&G into a kind of unified theory of desire. And I wonder, you know, you mentioned Hegel earlier. It seems to me that, when we talk about, you know, when G and G start talking about the synthesis of production and, you know, partial objects connect to one another, there's always a sense in which a certain partial object connects to another one, but at the expense of connecting to other ones. And it seems to me that negativity is built into this very process of the synthesis of production.
I don't know how D&G would respond and say, you know, well, you know, we don't want that negativity in there, but just the very differential logic you talked about earlier about, you know, an identity. If we talk about a specific connection being made, that's a kind of identity, and it comes at the expense of not connecting to other things. So it seems to me that, you know, we can't have a pure positive concept of desire nor a purely negative concept of desire. There's both negativity and positivity in any moment of desire, but I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, that's a really interesting question. Yeah, there are three things come to my mind in relation to that. All right, the first off, you know, I'm not sure that they have a good answer as to why one thing comes to relate to another thing, right? You know, it's almost, you know, why the synthesis goes in this direction rather than that direction. It's almost
choose the breast over the thumb in a specific instance, right? Like, the infant could just thumb opposed to the breast, and as far as what I've read, the little bit I've read, you're right. I don't seem to see any type of logic to why one happens. It seems to be kind of arbitrary.
Yeah, I mean, it just does, right? And things can, of course, be substituted for each other. The second observation here is that I do think it's noteworthy in Lacan that the term desire progressively disappears over the course of his teaching, right? And so, you know, around the 1950s and everything, it's desire all the time. When we get to Seminar 11, the four fundamental concepts of psychoanalysis, it's not treated as one of the fundamental concepts of psychoanalysis by Lacan. It's hardly discussed at all, and progressively it disappears and gets replaced by drive, desire, jouissance. And so there's something interesting going on there. Now, you know, if I have my Lacanian axe to grind as a psychoanalyst and all of these sorts of things, I do think it's noteworthy that in Lacan's responses to Hippolyte, when discussing the project essay, and I think you'll find these at the end in appendix to either Seminar 1 or Seminar 2, in his response to Hippolyte, where they're talking about the project essay, much to our surprise, Hippolyte is going on and on and on about Hegelian negativity and lack. Lacan is quite insistent that lack is not ontologically primitive or fundamental. It is derived, that there is a prior binding that has to take place in the primary system of the unconscious that generates the conditions for the possibility of a lack. And this sounds incredibly similar to arguments that Deleuze makes in Difference and Repetition, right, where Deleuze isn't denying that something can lack sunlight, for example, that a flower can lack sunlight or that it can lack water or that you can be hungry. His point is that there has to be a prior transcendental synthesis. He has a very different concept of synthesis than Kant does, but it's similar in some ways. There has to be a prior synthesis that first creates the possibility of something being missing, right? And that's a positivity. That's not a lack, right? It creates what we might say is something like akin to a place, right? Because you can't have something missing. He makes a lot of, you know, comments Lacan makes in the seminar on the Purloined Letter. He makes a lot of this idea of place, and nothing can be missing until it first has a place. Well, place is not a lack of something. It's the production of a lack, an affirmation that precedes that. Finally, third, for us, and in relation to your research and a project that you're working on, you know, one of the questions that we might ask in relation to capitalism, capitalist subjectivity, and the types of subjects that we are is the question, if we want to be cute and Kantian about it, what are the conditions for the possibility of a consumer? Right? And, you know, in order to produce a consumer, you have to produce a subject that experiences itself as lacking in some way or another that would be fulfilled by the commodity that it consumes or that it purchases. How do we install lack inside of subjectivity? What are the dynamics here that come to that lead us to see ourselves in these sorts of terms as something that needs to be satisfied by the Android or by PlayStation 4 or Fallout 4 or something like that. I hear a lot of people these days playing that game. Right? How does that happen? Right? How does that take place? And you know, here, right, Deleuze and Guattari, with respect to this sort of question, we converge, I think, in certain respects, to Baudrillard's earlier critique of Marx, where they say that the problem with Marx is that we can't, Marx, in Engels, predicted, right, that at a certain point, how does the story go? My mind is fuzzing out at this point, right? They predicted a certain demise of capitalism that would take place when contradictions reached a certain point. But what they failed to take into account, Baudrillard says, is symbolic value of things, right? The semiotic dimension of our experience, which seems to have no limit to the desires that we can produce in people. We aren't just, right, to use the Lacanian terminology, we aren't just creatures of needs, and we just, if we once and for all satisfied our need for food, shelter, and all those sorts of things, we are also creatures of desire. Desire is metonymous. We can create an endless number of hula hoop fads, game fads, car fads, and everything like that, that create endless markets for capitalism, right? And gosh, I mean, that's a sort of horrifying thought, right? That because there's no sort of markets that could be produced and demand for commodities that could be produced, capitalism in principle becomes a perpetual motion machine that could never then be abolished under those sorts of conditions.
Exactly, and it goes into, I've been thinking a lot about, the Soviet Union, and you can say that one of the biggest problems they had is they never transitioned into any form of consumerism like we know it. Because consumerism, it goes back to, the type of repression D&G talk about, where you want an identity so bad that it comes at the price of repression, and that's how consumerism functions. And Baudrillard tapped into that as well. I think the most interesting thing that I'm going to try to work on is bringing Baudrillard's take on consumerism into connection with D&G, because Baudrillard's right that sign value is this fundamental structure of the consumer society, but he also misses the material underpinning of it, which is the synthesis of production, where the partial objects connect and everything. And he was so such a good Frenchman of his time to be have a fetish with the signifier. But D&G, what I always have appreciated about their work is even though they were in this post-structuralist era, they were materialist. And I think that's where a lot of the key insights into capitalism come into play, where Baudrillard focuses on the signifier and the sign. They can talk about assemblages of machinic assemblages of bodies and the synthesis of production, and I think you need both of those. And I mean, D&G would be fine with it, because there's always an enunciative assemblage, as we learned in the course on 1,000 Plateaus. Any social formation is machinic assemblages and enunciative assemblages, and so you can kind of piggyback Baudrillard onto their ontology in that sense. But yeah, I think the key thing of consumerism is you don't buy objects, you buy a self. And that's precisely where all of the libidinal dynamics come into play, because you're not just investing in a toaster or a vacuum cleaner or anything. Somehow these all speak of your selfhood. And selfhood, it ceases to be, the classical notion of self of you are what you do. It transforms into you are what you buy or what you own. And that's how it keeps on going.
You're the kind of person that eats New Zealand lamb.
Right. And it speaks volumes. That's where your individuality lies. Baudrillard has a whole section in the Consumer Society on, the principle of differentiation, our personalization,
And that's, I mean, consumerism always is that. I mean, you know, growing up, you go to high school or whatever, and if somebody walked in with the exact same pair of Air Jordans you had on, you were pissed because you feel like it's an assault on your very identity, you know, and you see.
But of course, we all wanted to have the same thing as well, right? Yeah. At least in my high school, they all did. Everybody had to have the Coca-Cola sweatshirt. And
exactly. So it's weird. Baudrillard, you know, explains this where he's like, you know, but there's such conformism in consumerism as well. And the way you can have radical conformism in the guise of individualism is through marginal differences. So we all wear Air Jordans, but we wear different colored Air Jordans, right? And so if I wear the North Carolina blue Air Jordans, I'm an individual because that's my color, right? Like, so it's hyper-conformism masquerading as individualization.
Hmm. Yeah. All right, so I think that's about as long as I can go today. A great first meeting, I hope, I think. So next time we will be looking at Nietzsche and philosophy, and we will read Chapter 1 and Chapter 2, Sections 1 through 5. MP. And there is a syllabus that has been put up now.
In terms of the Nietzsche readings, are there any particular texts from Nietzsche that would be worth taking a look at that, like, Deleuze particularly talks about in those sections?
I would say Theology of Worlds would be the go-to text that he based a lot of his reading around.
Yeah, so. That's my favorite one anyway, so.
Yeah. So, all right, so I will see all of you next Thursday, and hopefully some other people will join us as well.
Thanks, Levi.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks.
Bye.
Take care. Bye.
Bye. Bye-bye.
Bye, everybody.
See you, Thera.